Peggy and Shahab walked up from the subway in the evening light. Her good spring coat was powder blue, her shoes were black and covered the insteps of her long feet. Her hat was beige with something dark along the crown, a brown feather or two. There was a certain asymmetry to her shoulders. She had a loping, hunchbacked walk. She had always a bit of black hair along her cheek, straggling to her shoulder, her bun coming undone. She carried her purse in the lightest clasp of her fingers down along the side of her leg, which made her seem listless and weary even as she covered the distance quickly enough, the gray sidewalk from subway to parlor floor and basement of the house next door. I was on the stoop of my own house waiting for my father. Peggy paused to say hello. She was not a pretty girl particularly. There was a narrowness to her eyes and a wideness to her jaw, crooked teeth, wild eyebrows, and a faint mustache. She had her Syrian father's thick, dark hair, but also the permanent scattered flush just under the fair skin of her Irish mother's broad cheeks. She had a job in Lower Manhattan in this, her first year out of manual training, and she said she didn't like the people there. She didn't like a single one of them. She ran a bare hand along the stone balustrade above my head. The other, which lightly held the strap of her purse, wore a dove gray glove. She had lost its partner somewhere, she said, and laughed with her crooked teeth. Fourth pair this month, she said, and left the library book she was reading on the subway yesterday, and look, tore her stocking on something. She shifted her black shoe to the step where I sat and pulled back the long coat and the skirt. I saw the laddered run, the flesh of Peggy's thin and dark-haired calf pressing through between each rung. The nail of the finger Peggy ran over its length was bitten down to nothing, but the movement of her hand along the tear was gentle and conciliatory, a kind of sympathy for her own flesh, which I imitated, brushing my own hand along the unbroken silk of Peggy's stocking and then over the torn threads of the run. "Amadon," Peggy said, "that's me. That's what I am."